Thank you. All right, guys, let's get started. We are right on time tonight. Good for us. Okay, not a ton to announce. If you're free Friday night and you want to see all the kids sing, they have the co-op Christmas program up at Providence in Rimlap. So many of us will be up there. There is a dinner right after it. I don't know what time it starts. There's no food? No food at all? No snacks? No turkey a la carte? No turkey a la king? No turkey sandwiches? They say there's no food, but I don't know if I believe it. All right. So anyway, that's Friday night. And then next Wednesday, we are still going to meet here for pizza, but we're going to try and go carol to Miss Jean and potentially Miss Lily May if they'll let us in. And then the two Wednesdays after that, the 22nd and the 29th, there is no Wednesday night church. And I believe that is it, except still, I know I haven't been announcing this every single time, but keep thinking about what we could potentially do for the youth conference the first weekend in March. And I still need to email out details to Dominion's History Conference about the best and worst presidents, which if you're interested in any of that, and I was thinking about maybe even any of you homeschool parents, that might be a few of those might be really educational for the kids as well. So I will send out the details on that as soon as I remember. But with that, let's get started.
Jesus, Lord of my soul, there Be seated. Turn with me to the book of Titus. We'll read once more the text of Titus chapter 1. Verses 5 through 9, looking at the qualifications of elders. So read with me, starting in verse 5. For this reason I left you in Crete, that you might set in order what remains and appoint elders in every city as I directed you. Namely, if any man be above reproach, the husband of one wife, having children who believe, not accused of dissipation or rebellion. For the overseer must be above reproach as God's steward, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not addicted to wine, not pugnacious, not fond of sordid gain, but hospitable, loving what is good, sensible, just, devout, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word, which is in accordance with the teaching, that he may be able both to exhort in sound doctrine and to refute those who contradict. Let's pray. Father, we praise you tonight. We thank you for the gospel. We thank you that in the power of the gospel, Lord, you have broken every chain of sin. Lord, there is no bondage for the Christian. There is no sin that can conquer us. We have all in Christ. Victory is ours. I pray, Lord, that Lord, you would make this real in our lives tonight. Lord, that though every chain is broken, I pray, Lord, that you would lead us to let go of these chains. If there's anyone in this room still, Lord, holding on to the chains of sin, Father, bring conviction, bring freedom. I pray this in the name of Christ for his glory. Amen. I want to begin tonight by telling a hypothetical story of a Christian. Imagine a Christian who truly loves Lord Jesus Christ and hates their sin. They honestly desire to glorify God in everything that they do. However, this Christian finds that, despite all of their sincere efforts, they continue to struggle with sin. More precisely, they struggle with very specific sins. And their continuous falling into these certain sins is so frequent, they wonder if their struggle is really an addiction. With continuous effort, this Christian tries to practice self-control over this specific sin, praying to God for victory, begging him for deliverance, but no deliverance is given. Some seasons in their life are better than others, but no matter how hard this Christian fights, this specific sin is never conquered. Friends, this is how the enemy works. This is his desire for you. He's not trying to get you to denounce Christ publicly. That's not how he's working, not at least right now in our culture where we live. How he is working is he wants you feeding on private sin. He wants to dig his hooks in into something that captivates you, that enslaves you, that no one knows about, that you hide, that you protect. And tonight, as we consider the qualification of self-control, this qualification touches every aspect of our life, including the public aspects of our life, the public demonstration of self-control, but it also touches the private aspects of our life and the private practice of self-control. And I think that private practice of self-control is really the key here. Right? Publicly, there are many motives for practicing self-control. privately, it's just you and God. That is where the true measure of self-control is tested, private. And indeed, many pastors have lost their qualification as an elder because of a private failure in self-control that kept going and going and going until it built up into a public display and failure of self-control. My brothers who are pastors, does a story have any sort of resonation in your life? The idea of a sin that is so specific to each and every one of you that it hurts, that you know it. It's continual. Christians in this room, does that hypothetical story ring a bell? I imagine if we went around the room and we were honest, that many would say, yes, there is sin in my life. There's sin in my life that really only comes when I'm alone. I struggle to practice self-control. And it happens so frequently, I wonder if it is addiction. So tonight as we look at this, indeed we're looking at the qualification of an elder, but as we unpack self-control, friends, this is a powerful qualification, a powerful thing, self-control. There's freedom in it. There's freedom in owning and experiencing self-control. And then by the power of Christ, we have that. And there is no sin powerful enough to overcome you in the power of Christ. There's nothing that you cannot have self-control over in Christ. So let's begin. We're going to start by exposing a couple of lies. First lie. The enemy would have you believe that self-control is simply a matter of effort and nothing else. Self-control is simply exertion. It's just trying harder. Satan wants you to believe that biblical self-control is simply trying harder. Nothing else needs to change. Just next time when this sin comes, just try harder. That will grant you success and self-control. That is a lie. Brothers and sisters, biblical self-control is far more than effort. It's far more than just being really passionate. Far more than just desire. I really want self-control over this thing, and I'm going to try to want it more next time. That's part of it. That's far from all. The enemy wants you to think this, wants you living in this way, because this breeds discouragement. If he can have you thinking that all you need to do is try harder, then nothing will change in your life. Next time, you'll commit to yourself, you'll commit to God, I'll just try harder, and you will fail. And in that, time after time after time after time, this sin prospers in privacy, and you're discouraged. I mean, what's the point of striving? I've fallen 50 times. I've fallen 150 times, 1,000 times. I've lost count. What's the point? And if I can't not do this sin, what's the point of repenting of it? I have to repent of this thing every week. It's just fake. What's the point? That's lie number one. Lie number two. Satan wants you to believe that eventually this sin that you struggle to have self-control over eventually will no longer be a problem. At some point, God will sanctify you. You know, you'll hit that age where maturity somehow lands on you and you'll no longer struggle with this sin. It's just eventually this will happen. To the parent, he says, look, eventually your kids will not be so difficult. Instructing them in biblical discipline, not being lazy, not losing your temper, these things that you struggle to have self-control over, eventually they will be older. Just wait till then. To young people, he says, look, eventually God will save my boyfriend. And my desire to have this relationship now, which is sinful, I don't need to handle this now. Eventually, God will fix this. Eventually, it will be fixed. To the wife, he says, eventually my husband will be worth submitting to. I mean, I cannot be expected to submit to this buffoon right now. He's not mature enough. He's not wise enough. Eventually he will be. That's when I will submit to this man. To men especially, but to women as well. And it's important that I include women in this. Oh, and the enemy loves this lie, especially right now. He says, look, just wait until you get married. The sin of pornography will not be a temptation after you get married. There's an understanding that you're young. There's some Bible verse out there that says, you know, it's better to get married than to burn with lust. So if I'm not married, it's kind of understood that I'm going to burn with lust. And I can practice pornography. And then after I get married, that temptation will be gone. Friends, let's just dispel this one right now. If you're waiting for marriage to break the sin of pornography, you are doomed. Pornography and the temptation of it does not end when you get married. See how the enemy works? You see the lie of the enemy? Just punt. Don't worry with this sin now. Eventually, it'll be taken care of. So friends, as we begin this journey into self-control, two very important things. We all need to know that right now, today, in the pew, or the folding chairs in the back, you have everything you need to conquer every sin in your life. Everything. You have it all right now in Christ. You're in need of nothing else. Do not wait. And that's the second piece. You have everything you need to conquer this sin, and you must conquer this sin right now. You have what you need, and you're commanded to use it now. Do not tolerate sin. It's how the enemy works. He wants it protected. He wants it to endure. He wants it private. So before we get to this self-control, as you can imagine, tonight might be a little bit of an intense sermon if I'm already this amped up. But before we jump in, let's hopefully take a moment of encouragement. We should be encouraged, and you should be encouraged, that self-control is in this list. Like, when you just think about the very definition of self-control, it necessitates that the self has evil desires. So if you find in yourself this repetitive and intense craving for sin, I mean, vile, wicked sin, that's okay. I mean, look, this list is about the qualifications of pastors, right? The end goal while on earth is not get so holy that you stop craving sin. That's not a qualification. The qualification is to control those desires. So friends, be encouraged. That secret evil craving that you are ashamed of, it's okay that that is there. In fact, your acknowledgement and your recognition that that is there, that is a sign that the Holy Spirit is in you, and you feel that, and it hurts. So be encouraged, right? 1 John 1:8 says, if we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Romans chapter 7, man, you got to live in that thing. What a beautiful chapter of scripture where the Apostle Paul talks about his wickedness and his struggle. Who will set me free from this body of death? I love that verse. Be encouraged. So let's begin. So what is to be done? We fight. What is to be done with self-control? How do we practice self-control? How do we grow in self-control? We fight. But we fight with the weapons that God has given us. Some of you are sprinting forth to war with all the sincerity that you can muster, but you left your weapons at home. Do not bring a knife to the gunfight of self-control. We fight, but we fight with weapons. There's two weapons that we're going to talk about tonight. I'm not saying that they're the only two weapons in all of Scripture for practicing self-control, but man, they're critical. And I will promise you, I will put my character on the line, my credibility. Christian, if you will practice these two things, you will have victory over every sin in your life. Not that you will never sin again, but sin will not rule you. We have been given weapons and they work. The Holy Spirit of God resides in you. You have the power of Christ. There is nothing the enemy can do to you when we take the weapons Scripture has given us. So these two weapons, weapons number one, or weapon number one, dismemberment. The word dismemberment, it means to cut off an arm or cut off a leg. It's a little bit of a severe word, severe picture. I think you know it's not my word or my picture. That's the Lord Jesus that used that picture. Weapon number one, dismemberment. So what does that look like? It is the opposite of my daughter Hadley looking at the Christmas tree. If you don't know my daughter Hadley, she's about to be two. She's the rambunctious one in the back that always finds these random moments to yell amen during our worship service. She's a little bit rambunctious. She loves the Christmas tree, right? She's just now hitting that age. Last year, she was too young. Now she's like, Dad, there's a tree in the room. Why is there a tree in the house? You know, we put lights on it. She still doesn't understand what it is, but it's fascinating to her, right? She likes to learn. She's trying to say the word Christmas tree. She's allowed to look at the Christmas tree. She's not allowed to touch the Christmas tree. This was going swimmingly until Hadley's grandmother encouraged her to smell the Christmas tree. And as you can imagine, Hadley still is not allowed to touch the Christmas tree. She's right here. I'll be sitting in my chair. She'll look at me. She'll be like, Daddy, no touch. I'm like, that's right. But then she smells. Friends, that is the opposite of dismemberment. And friends, some of you in this room are too comfortable 2 inches from your sin. This is a very important thing. If you hold temptation this close and you pray to God and you beg him for deliverance, he will not give it. He will not bless that prayer. That is nowhere in Scripture. As long as you hold fast to the sin and the temptation in your life, do not expect deliverance. That is not how self-control works. Romans 13, 14. My friends, you need to memorize this verse. If struggling with sin, especially a certain sin, is a problem for you, you need to memorize this verse. Romans 13, 14 says, let us behave properly as in the day, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual promiscuity and sensuality, not in strife and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ. I've probably heard that before. The next phrase is so vital. And make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts. Matthew 5, 29 through 30. Christ said, if your right eye makes you stumble, tear it out and throw it from you. For it is better for you to lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. If your right hand makes you stumble, cut it off and throw it from you. For it is better for you to lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. Friends, begging God for deliverance while still grasping the provision for your sin, you will never have victory doing that. The Lord has instructed you in a different way. You are never in your Christian life supposed to reach some point where through some supernatural power, you can surround yourself with temptation and you never fall. That is not the Christian life. My friends, if you struggle with pornography and you carry a smartphone with you every day, don't ever expect to be free of it. Not until you have rid yourself of that temptation and that addiction. If you struggle with gossip and envy and jealousy and pride, and yet you still have your social media accounts, don't expect freedom and victory over those sins. Tear it out and throw it from you. Cut it off and throw it from you. If I had a dollar every time I heard a young lady tell me that her social media was a temptation to her to such a degree that she's going to delete it, and then 2 weeks later turns it back on, I would have a few dollars. Our enemy is so strategic in this. There's nothing wrong with the smartphone. There's nothing wrong with a social media account. The enemy finds a way to give us legitimate reasons to hold on to the provision for our flesh. I need it for work. I know this is a source of addiction for me, but I have to have a smartphone for work. My social media account, man, that's where I do my evangelism. You know, I post my Bible verse on there every once in a while. It's how I share my pictures with my parents. It's how I stay connected to friends. Christian, every single chain of sin has been broken by the Holy Spirit. Every one of them. But as long as you grasp that broken chain, you will feed on that sin. It will rule you. So do not do what Hadley does. Do not stand this close to your temptation. Hadley often touches the tree by accident in her endeavor to smell it. And she gets punished. She's broken the rule. Friends, we carry around the provision for our flesh so frivolously. Does your smartphone cause you to sin? Here's this insane idea. Get rid of your smartphone. They still sell flip phones, promise you. Is it an iPad? Is it the TV? Is it a desktop monitor? What is it in your life that is a provision for flesh? Again, it is a deceit from the enemy, this idea that at some point I need to reach this maturity where these things aren't temptations. Friend, that is not how Scripture works. That's not how the Holy Spirit works. You might say, I'll just put a fence around the tree. If you've been to my house, we used to have a little toddler fence. My friends saved our life. You need to get one of those things. If you got 2-year-olds, especially if you got two of them, and you just block off certain parts of the house and you just fence them in, it's fantastic. Hadley might say, look, I'll just put a fence around this tree. You know what I mean? Then I can still kind of get close, you know, not 2 inches, maybe a foot. Friends, Hadley should sneak right now, drive the car home, cut the tree down, and put it in the front yard. Right? That is what is required for her to never touch that tree again. And scripturally, if you follow my metaphor, that's what she's commanded to do. And Christian, that is what you are commanded to do with your temptation. So friend, the smartphone, the social media, I know those things are fun. I know there's real legitimate use in them. But Christian, just clear as day, Joshua 24, 15, I challenge you with this scripture. Choose this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods your fathers served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. This is what is required if you want victory over your sin. Choose Christ. And it will cost you something. If it really hurts to give up this provision, praise God. The angels will sing in glory for the gospel fruit of his saints. That's one of them. If it didn't cost you anything, who cares? Beware the paper cut. Jesus did not say, take a butter knife to the arm. You know, flick the eye. Cut it off. Throw it from you. You might say, I'll just get that explicit content blocker thing. You know, or that tracking software that sends an email, you know, to my accountability brother. Maybe I'll delete my Facebook because I don't really use it anymore and no one really uses it anymore. But my Instagram, I mean, can't get rid of that one. I promised you guys that if you followed Scripture and you obeyed your Father in this way, that you would have complete victory. My friends, you take a butter knife to your provision you will not. It's that simple. And of course, these are just two examples that may not apply to you. So friend, I challenge you, take this and search your heart. Take this approach of making no provision, tearing out your eye, cutting off your arm, throwing it from you. That is what must be done in the life of the Christian for their provision. And if you're like me, you have a specific sin that is so enjoyable. It is so hard not to do. I know what that is. I have a sneaky feeling you know what yours is right now. Maybe more than one. But you're protecting. You've thought about getting rid of this one thing so many times, and yet you still have it for good reasons. Weapon number one, dismemberment. Weapon number two, prayer. Prayer for self-control. Matthew 26, verse 41, Jesus told his disciples, "Keep watching and praying that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." What a beautiful verse. Keep watching and praying. Why? So that you would not enter into temptation. Why? Well, your spirit is willing, your flesh is weak. Friend, just because you remove all the provision from your life, go be a monk in a monastery, does not mean temptation will not find you. It will. It does not mean that your flesh is not weak. It is, and it always will be. So the solution to that, in addition to those other scriptures we just talked about, that you must do, pray. Pray that you would not enter into temptation. Here's some words to pray. Man, I struggle to not read every psalm in the Psalms. Picked out just a couple really good ones. But Psalm 25, I challenge you, pray scripture. Pray these phrases. In Psalm 25, David said, "Look upon my enemies, for they are many. They hate me with a violent hatred. Guard my soul and deliver me." That is a glorious thing to pray. God, guard my soul, deliver me. In Psalm 38, "Lord, do not forsake me. Oh my God, do not be far from me. Make haste to help me, oh Lord, my salvation." Pray and ask God to make haste to help you. And beautiful Psalm 51, these words, "Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. Sustain me with a willing spirit." Friends, your Father loves you. You think there's a chance he will not answer these prayers? You think there's a chance if Hadley cried out to me, begging me to help, when she was messing with death, that I would just pass her by when I had the power to save her? Friends, God has the power to save you. In temptation, in sin, it is deathly to you. Pray. Pray these things. Pray for self-control over your sin. And this one's not necessarily a prayer, but I just had to say this. Psalm 34. "The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and rescues them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. How blessed is the man who takes refuge in him." I love this picture. The angels are not just circled around you. They got tents and campfires. They're roasting hot dogs around you. They're encamped. There's a permanent presence around you as a child of God. How blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Part of that refuge is the rest of Scripture, which directs us in what we are to do. So after you get the gun of dismemberment, you got one more hand, take the gun of prayer and fight. Fight against sin. Fight for self-control over sin. Don't loft up some pitiful prayer and some pitiful effort in your fight against sin. Friend, have some gumption about you and your practice of self-control. Hebrews 12, 1 through 4 says, Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. You have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood in your striving against sin. You have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood in your striving against sin. Friend, that is the measure of the effort you must put in as a child of God. Shedding of your own blood and striving against sin. Some of us need to pray more. Some of us need to dismember some provision. Some of us need a spiritual Red Bull. Let's go. Follow Christ. Heed the call. Live in righteousness. Be holy as he is holy. And to my three brothers who are elders, you know what a scorched earth policy is? It's actually a military thing. It's where you burn anything that might be useful to the enemy. Brothers, scorched earth policy. What could the enemy use against me in my personal fight against sin? Burn it. Cut that thing off. Catapult that thing away from you. Protect yourself and so protect the flock of God. And as we close, friends, remember this temporary struggle is almost over. I mean, we are close. I know it doesn't feel that way. We think about what's going on tomorrow. Friends, Christ is coming back tomorrow. It is close at hand. You will be with your Savior. Your struggle is almost over. Remember that, and remember that the eternal struggle has been won. There is no fight for eternity. We'll say that one more time. I mean, this is so paramount that you understand this. The fight for your soul and its eternity is over. Do not fight for God's love. Do not exert yourself for God's forgiveness. Do not strive for grace. Do not pressure yourself for mercy. That has already been given to you. You cannot earn it. The eternal struggle is over and has been won by Christ. 1 John 2, 1 through 2. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. I love this. Why is he writing it? So that you wouldn't sin. Like, that's the purpose in what he's saying. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also those of the whole world. Christian, fight against sin. Take the weapons of Scripture and fight. And then rest. Rest in the fact that salvation has been won. Rest in the propitiation that is what Christ has done. You have an advocate with the Father. It has nothing to do with you, but what Jesus has done on your behalf. Jesus Christ, the righteous. And you have that righteousness through faith in Christ. Fight and then rest. We will be with him soon. Do it for the glory of his name. Amen. Let's praise him, shall we? Stand and sing.
Jesus, I do not.